Since we are going to heavily use the notion of coherent topology, and in particular the so-called compactly generated topology, let us recall a few fundamental facts about them, which will be useful for us throughout, especially while dealing with CW complexes. It may be recalled that a special case of coherent topology was introduced as well as used in part one. So we assume that you know these things, but let us recall these things in somewhat quick fashion. That is one of the reasons why the module 6 is released to you before module 5, that we are going to use this coherent topology in module 5. Okay, yeah, so let us begin with the general theorem here, namely start with a family of topological spaces. I have denoted them by xi, comma tau I because I want to specifically mention these tau i's here. Okay, be a family of topological spaces and look at some family of functions from xi to x, so which is denoted by curly f. These are just septetic functions because I haven't taken any topology on x right now. Okay, now you put tau f is equal to all subsets of x such that for every I, their inverse image belongs to tau I. So inverse image must be an open subset in tau I for every I. So that is a collection. Then the statement is that tau f is a topology on X with the property that each fi is continuous. Moreover, it is the maximal topology on X with this property. Okay, the proof is very straightforward and elementary. And straightforward means whatever you are supposed to do, you have to, there is no trick involved here. Okay. So look at this, for example. Continuity of Fi follows because Fi inverse of an open set, by definition, open set in tau F, okay, by definition, Fi inverse must be tau I in open in the xi. Okay, so this is very clear that if this is a topology, then with respect to this one, each fi is continuous. Verifying that this topology and the maximality of this topology, etc., is easy. Okay. Following the above theorem, we now make a definition. The topology tau f defined in the above theorem is called topology on X co-induced by the collection Fi. To indicate that it has something to do with F, we'll denote it by X, comma tau F. Okay, so we can have shorter notation by XF. So it is the co-induced topology with respect to this family F. Most of the time we will be considering a special case wherein each fi is an inclusion map of the sets xi to x, where x is a larger set and all these xi's are subsets of x with their own topologies. So that is the situation that we want to apply this one. So let us see in this special case what are the properties of this topology. Let X be the union of Xi's, where each Xi is a topological space. Let tau equal to tau of eta be the topology on X, okay, where this co-induced by the family eta, which is eta I from x to x are all inclusive maps. I have also assumed that union is precisely equal to x here. Okay, so that is a special case here. A subset A of x is open or respectively closed in tau if and only if A intersection xi is open or respectively closed in xi for each I. So this is the first statement of the theorem. The second statement says that if you take the disjoint union of xi, then x being the ordinary union will be automatically a quotient set. It is a quotient map. Okay. So that let us take the quotient map Q of x is nothing but the inclusion map, whatever x is in some one of the xi. So take eta I of x for x belong to xi. Okay. Any surjective map or a surjective function is a quotient function set theoretically. But now you can give a co-induced topology tau on x is nothing but the quotient topology coming from the disjoint union topology on xi. So when you take disjoint union, the co-induced topology is the same thing as the so-called disjoint union topology, which is nothing but a subset is open if and only if, you know, each part in each A intersection xi is open inside xi. All those open subsets from various things take the union, they are the open subsets of disjoint union xi. So that is the simplest case of co-induced topology. From there, we take an arbitrary union and get this one. Okay. Once again, verification of A and B are very straightforward. You have to just look at the meaning of F inverse of A, where Fy inverse of A is nothing but when Fy is eta I, is nothing but A intersection xi, that's all. Okay. So, and then B is an immediate consequence of A, because in the quotient topology is also what is the definition? Definition of quotient topology is that something is open here if and only if its inverse image in each xi is open. Inverse image in the total union is open, which means intersection with each xi is open. So you get this one. Okay. So now we would like to make one more special case in which you can extend the neighborhoods. Okay. So for that, you go back to proposition. Let me just recall proposition 1.1. So here we had this family of attached cells attached to a Y. So X was obtained by attaching cells to Y, right? Then we had these extensions of neighborhoods. So similar to this, this is much very much elaborate and much more structured, but there is a very simple extension of this one in that purely topological spaces, and that is what we would like to brought your attention to. So let us see what is that. So you come here, let Y contained as X be a closed subset. That's all, I naught. Not that X is obtained by attaching cells and so on. Suppose A contained set X is any set and V is an open subset of X such that A inside V. Okay. Suppose U is an open set in Y such that A intersection Y, U is an open subset of Y, itself. A intersection Y is contained inside U, because U is an open subset of Y, but U itself is contained inside this V intersection, this V intersection Y. Okay, then there exists an open subset V prime in X such that A is contained inside V prime, contained inside V, and V prime intersection Y is precisely U. So what I have done is that for the part of A inside Y, U was a neighborhood inside Y. That U gets extended to a neighborhood of A, extended neighborhood of A, okay, inside the whole of X, but contained inside the original neighborhood V. So that's the meaning of this. The V prime is contained inside V. V prime intersection Y is U. So this is what I mean by extending neighborhoods. Okay, you can extend the neighborhood, but at the same time you can control it so that it is not too large. So it is, it's contained inside an already which is a neighborhood. Okay, so this is an ordinary statement for subsets from a closed subset from Y to X, which we can now generalize to a large extent. So that is what we are doing there. So the proof of this one is very straightforward, though it looks somewhat complicated and all that. So here I have drawn a picture. So in this picture, so whole area is, you can take it as the whole plane as X, and this square is Y. Okay. Then this hexagon represents A. Okay. A intersection this part Y. Okay. This part Y that is contained inside this U intersection Y. Okay, this dotted thing is U intersection Y. I deliberately written now like this because U may be, as an open subset, could be anything that you don't know where it's going. Okay, but it must be intersection must be contained inside V. V is this ellipse, the area closed by ellipse. Okay, so under this situation, what I'm doing here, the proof. Proof this, let W contained inside X be an open subset in X such that W intersection Y is U. That is the meaning of that U is open inside Y. So Y is a subspace topology. So there is an open subset like this. After that, you just take V prime equal to V minus Y. So this part, open part here, okay, union W intersection V, only the portions, you know, W intersection V part you have to take. So this part, for example, is outside V, you should don't take. Okay. So once I have written down this one, all that you have to verify that this V prime is open and A intersection Y is contained in V prime intersection Y is exactly equal to U. And after that, is very clear. V prime is contained inside V is very clear. Okay, you verify that one. Yeah. So that is just one set at a time. Now we want to generalize it to a larger extent. So here again, take X to be the union of all the Xi's. Each Xi is a closed subset of Xi plus 1, the next one. Okay, so they are subspaces in some sense, a union system. I have taken subspaces, closed subspaces. Okay, and X is given the co-induced topology with respect to the family of inclusion maps from Xi to X. X itself may not have topology to begin with. Each Xi is a topological space. And each Xi is a subspace of Xi plus 1, and it's a closed subset of Xi. So this is the hypothesis. Okay. And then we give the topology X eta to tau eta to X. Okay. That is the co-induced topology. Now suppose B is an arbitrary subset of X contained inside W. Okay. And W is such that intersection with each Xi is a neighborhood of B intersection Xi. If B is a subset of F, B intersection I will be a subset of Xi. So this W intersection I is a neighborhood of B intersection Xi in Xi. Then W itself is a neighborhood of B in X. Recall that a neighborhood means what? Hey, something is W is a neighborhood of A means what? There is an open subset U such that A is contained inside U, contained inside W. This is what you have to prove finally. Then W is a neighborhood of this one. I have to find an open subset. Now here, neighborhood, W intersection Xi is a neighborhood. We are not given any open set. There is some open set. So each time you take open subset, they may be different. When you intersect with the previous Xi, they may not coincide with the old one and so on. That is the problem here. Otherwise, suppose I change the neighborhood to open neighborhood here and open neighborhood here, then this is obvious from the definition of Poynter's topology. W itself is a open set, right? So point is that open neighborhood has been replaced by arbitrary neighborhood here. That's why you have to prove this statement. And this comes from step by step by the previous lemma. Okay, so we appeal to the previous lemma with each time take x equal to xi plus 1 and y equal to xi. Then xi, then y is a closed subset of xi, x, and a equal to xi intersection b, b equal to xi intersection w for each i. We then have, this is a neighborhood now, then inductively we can choose open sets ui in xi such that b intersection xi is contained inside ui, contained inside w intersection xi, and ui gets extended to ui plus 1. So ui plus 1 intersection xi is ui. So this is the statement of the lemma. The lemma gives you that one. So this you do for each I, then you take u equal to union of uis. When you take intersection of this one with xi, it will be precisely equal to ui. Okay? Because all the larger ones, ui plus 1 intersection xi is ui, ui plus 2 intersection xi plus 1 itself is ui plus 1, intersection with that one will be again ui and so on. So they all will be equal to ui. Therefore, what happens is this u becomes open subset. So b is contained inside u because b intersection xi is contained inside ui, and all of them are contained in w intersection xi, right? So finally it will contain in w. Okay. Now we shall study what is the relation, if at all. It's not a complete answer, but what is the relation between the topology on X and the Poynter's topology on X? Suppose you start with topology on X, and these Xi's are subspaces. Now you can come back and give the Poynter's topology on X. Is there some relation? This is what we want to study, but we are not going to complete answer here, okay? But some sufficient conditions on which this happens is our is this theorem now. So start with x equal to union of xi, where each xi is given a topology tau i, okay? Assume that the following compatibility conditions are satisfied. Namely, CC1 is for each pair ij, the two topologies on xi intersection xj induced from xi tau I and xj tau j are the same. So this is subspace topologies on the intersections coming from the two different sets must be the same. That is the first condition. Second condition is a more generous condition. For each pair ij, intersection xi xj is an open subset of both xi and xj. You can replace open by respectively closed subsets. So that's a separate statement. For all of ij's, you have to do that. Okay? So either you take all of them open or all of them closed. So that is CC2. With these two conditions, Now, if tau is the induced power, co-induced power zone X with respect to the family eta I, that namely inclusion maps, then the subspace topology is tau xi. You see, tau i's are already given topology. Now, subspace topology tau xi is coming from tau eta for each xi, coincides with tau I, old topology. Moreover, each xi is open or closed in X according to condition CC2. So this is the beginning of our attempt to understand what happens to the X itself. On xi's, okay, so what we did, we have started with some topologies, gave the co-induced topology on X, then look at the subspace topology. Will those will be the same? That's the question. Whatever topology you have on X, okay, if these are subspace topologies on each xi, then you go to intersection. There will be two different ways of doing this. Namely, first come to xi and then go to xi intersection xj, or secondly, come to xj and then take the intersection. Both of them will be subspace of the original X. Therefore, they must coincide. Therefore, condition CC1 is a must. So this is a necessary condition. You have to put this one, no matter. But this condition is not necessary. This is a generous condition. This will actually imply whatever we want. But whatever we want may be there without this strong condition. Okay, so we have to be somewhat apologetic about this one. That such an affirmative answer, you know, condition CC1 is a must. It is a necessary condition. Second condition is not necessary, but it is sufficient. It is stronger condition. Okay, the proof is very straightforward. We need to check that the original topology tau I is the same thing as tau eta restricted to xi, okay, for each I. Of course, by the definition of tau, what is the definition of this tau eta in coin topology? Each eta is a continuous function. From where to where? From the original tau I to tau restricted to xi. Therefore, tau eta xi is contained inside tau I. Open subsets of this one will have to be open here. Okay, the inclusion map itself is continuous. Therefore, this must one way is clear. Now let us prove that tau I is contained inside tau restriction xi. Okay. So first consider the case when xi intersection xj is open in both xi and xj. So we are using the second condition also now. And second condition has two in two different cases. One is all of them open, one all of them closed, second one. So let us take the case when xi intersection open in both x and xj. To begin with, this condition itself will imply that each xi is open in tau. Right? Because fix xi, when it is open in tau in the coin super by very definition, intersection with each xj must be open. And that is what it is. So each xi is open in tau. But then if A is open in xi, it will be open in X also. Right? Open subset of an open subset is open. Okay, if A is an open subset of xi, then it will be open in xi also. Therefore, tau I, whatever you take tau I, okay. Tau I means what? Some open subset in xi must be open inside tau. So it means xi is contained inside tau restricted to xi. Okay, the same way now you can use for closeness also. Okay, the second case is similar. Xi intersection xj is closed in xj. For every j implies xi itself is closed in x tau. Hence, each closed subset of xi, closed subset of a closed subset is closed. Okay, so similar. All right. So there are nice theories here about the first question that I raised here, but we will not need them, so I am skipping them. So let us now go to another special case of this Coindus topology, namely compactly generated topology. Okay. So we make a notation here. Take any topological space to start with. Okay, then look at all the compact subsets with their induced topology, subspace topologies. So there's a family of subsets, right? Topological spaces. And look at the inclusion maps. So those maps will co-induce a topology on X. That topology is denoted by XW. This is the classical notation. Is referred to as weak topology for some reason. Okay, so that's why XW. Usually one calls it a weak topology. Topology co-induced by a set of compact subsets of X. Okay, so what is the relation between X and X tau, X and X W? That is what we would like to understand. This is going to be very, very important, so please pay your attention. So take start with any topological space. The very first thing to notice that is identity map is continuous. What is the meaning of this? Every set which is open in X is already open in XW also. So in other words, there are more open sets here. So XW is finer than X. Though it's called weak topology, don't be under the assumption that it is weaker than the original topology X. It is not that. It is finer. Okay. Identity defines a bijection of compact sets in the two topologies. Though there are more open sets here, the set of compact subsets is the same as set of compact subsets of X. That is the beauty of this topology. So that is part B here. The third condition is that, third statement is that, if F from X to Y is continuous, then the same map F, when you change the topologies on both sides to weak topology, XW to YW, is also continuous. Okay, so let us see how A and B work out. Then I will leave C to you to work it out. All right. Recall that a subset S of X is closed in XW. I'm just recalling the definition of weak topology here. If and only S intersection K, where K is a compact subset, is closed in K. This should happen for every K. That is the meaning of that X, something is closed in XW, that this topology is compactly generated or co-induced by the family of compact sets. This will be the case if S itself is closed in X. If something is closed in the whole space, intersection with each subspace will be closed in that subspace. So in particular, intersection with each compact set will be closed. Okay, so therefore, this proves A, namely something is closed in X, then it is closed in XW. By taking the complement, it is open in X, it will be open in XW. Okay, now the second one, if K is compact in XW, we want to show that it is compact in X, but identity map is continuous. Image of a compact set is compact, therefore K is compact in X also. The converse is important. Take a K which is a compact subset of X. Why it is in compact in XW? Okay, that's what you have to show. Let K be a compact subset in X. that F be a family of subsets of K closed in XW with finite intersection property. Now I want you to remember that to show something is compact is the following, namely take a family of closed subsets which is finite intersection property, then show that intersection of all these is non-empty. Okay, by De Morgan law, this is same thing as saying that if you take an open cover, then there is a finite subcover. Okay, just by taking De Morgan law, these two are equivalent. So I just wanted to recall, that's all. So I am going to use that property here. Let F be a family of subsets of K closed in XW with finite intersection property. By the very definition of XW, for each F in F, these are closed subsets, we have F equal to F intersection K, okay, they are subsets of K after all, is closed in K. Okay. See, they were closed subsets of XW means now F is a closed subset of K. Since K is compact in the ordinate topology, now we have passed into ordinate topology here, ordinate topology. K is compact, follows that intersection is non-empty. So this is set, intersection of all F is non-empty, is what we wanted to prove. All right. So we leave part three, how to show this is continuous, to you. Okay. However, let us make now this definition. A space is said to be compactly generated if and only this identity map, which is we have seen that it's continuous, must be a homeomorphism, which means that identity map the other way around is also continuous, which just means that the original open subsets remain open and nothing more comes, though the topologies are the same. Okay. So this XW is compactly generated always. If X is equal to XW, then X itself is called compactly generated. Okay. So here is a remark. If you use this one, everything will be easy for you. So what are these? Take a compact subset K. Then a function f from K to X is continuous if and only if K to XW is continuous. Okay, K can be any compact space and f equal to any function. Suppose now X is compactly generated. Then a function from X to Y is continuous if and only if every compact subset K of X, the restricted function F restricted to K from K to Y is continuous. This fact B is going to be the key to understand compactly generated topology and its use in constructing continuous functions. Okay, so this will be used again and again in the CW complex. I have emphasized this one several times. In the situation of this theorem, 1.6, I want to write history, let us see. So this is an exercise, theorem 1.6, assume that Xi is Hausdorff, then prove that X is Hausdorff. Let me just recall what is this exercise, what is this theorem, huh? The theorem was that union of Xi's, one contained in the other and so on, and then extended neighborhood you have to prove. So you may have to use this to prove that exercise, okay? It's not very difficult, but you have to work out. So that is roughly what we wanted to tell about co-induced topologies and compactly generated topologies. Okay, thank you.